It's so wonderful to see so many of you here today, and welcome to all the new faces and new faculty. I'm so pleased to welcome you to the third annual College of Liberal Arts and Sciences State of the College. I'm Karen Marangel. I'm Dean of the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences and a professor of mathematics and statistics. It's been a tradition at this event for the president to address us, and this year, the president will be offering his thoughts on the future of Portland State as he embarks on his last year as president of our university. Vim, thank you for your excellent leadership over the past 8 years, and welcome.
Thank you. Actually, Karen, I have to correct you in the sense that it has only been a very short tradition for me to be invited to this convocation. It's really been since you've been the dean the last 3 years that we have done that. Before that, it did not happen. So thank you, because it's been a pleasure to have a chance to be here. Let me just ask for a quick show of hands, because then I know what to talk about or not talk about. How many of you were at the convocation 2 days ago? Okay, a good number. So I will talk about some things similar and some things different, all right? But as we all know from our teaching, most of us can stand to hear things twice, so it should be all right. First of all, of course, welcome back. For those of you who actually were gone during the summer, I know many of you were here either teaching or doing research or whatnot. I hope many of you at least had a chance to do something other than focusing on your work and refresh your brain. I had the wonderful pleasure of spending 2 weeks in South Africa. My wife Alice and I had bought 6 nights at a game lodge at the athletics fundraiser 2 years ago. And so we got to go there, and then in addition got to spend time in Cape Town, both learning about their beautiful nature, about their wonderful wines, and of course about some of the socioeconomic racial issues that still are deeply entrenched there. But it really, truly, I feel during a trip like that my brain literally gets rewired from what I do the rest of the time. I'm sure that some of you scientists would be able to describe whether there's actually any literal truth to that, but it certainly feels that way to me. I want to celebrate, those of you who were there at the convocation, I talked about how at PSU we're always extremely aware of that, that we have all kinds of struggles always, historically we've had to struggle to survive, and that we also always have lots of hope, which definitely we feel in September as the new academic year starts, but that we do not spend enough time on being a place of glory to celebrate all of our achievements. So I just want to start with just, and this was just random thoughts that I had as I thought about this, an hour ago about what I would say to you, just the things that pop into my mind when I think about your college, the excellence of the history department, the incredible, wonderful way in which the Center for Japanese Studies produces both cultural activities, intellectual activities, and connects up deeply with the Portland community. The research funding success in so many of your departments, biology, chemistry, environmental sciences, and so on. The incredibly powerful faculty in mathematics, and in 2 weeks I'm actually flying down to Southern California to talk to Farbors Massey to gauge his interest in a renewed investment to be able to continue the growth of that department. Last year, I visited several departments, and the one that really stood out was my meeting with World Languages and Literature, and just the energy and optimism that I enjoy in their profession that I saw in that department was just really wonderful to see. At some of my faculty receptions, I've met such great new faculty. So I particularly remember some of the ones in geology, but I know they're in other departments as well, just where they had the opportunity to hire several new people at a time and just bringing a whole new spirit to that area. And then, of course, I hope that all of you are excited of the prospect of the renovation of Neuberger, even though I know that will cause some short-term pain and aggravation, it will definitely be worth it. And I know that in having mentioned some things, some of you are sitting there, well, what am I, chopped liver? No, you're not. But, you know, it would get very boring if I made a point of listing every single department. But, you know, there are just so many great things going on. And, you know, you are half the university, you know, in terms of students, in terms of faculty, you're approximately half the university. So you're doing well is really what makes Portland State as a whole do well. And I've just been very excited about Karen's leadership during these past 3 years. The new leadership you've brought in, people like Shirley and others who I think are just great academic leaders. And again, it affirms to me, obviously as a president, I do believe in the importance of leadership. It's not the only thing by any stretch. It's the daily work that you do that makes up the bulk of the university. But leadership can inspire and direct and make a difference that matters. I also laid out in the convocation speech some of the challenges ahead, all of which pretty much are also mentioned in the strategic plan. You know, the first one I mentioned was the issue of student retention, which of course is a key part of the first goal of the strategic plan of elevating student success. And that one, more than almost anything we do, is so much something that all of us need to be thinking about. Because obviously what happens in your classroom, in your lab, and in your offices when you're casual meetings with students is one big factor on determining whether students feel at home here, whether they feel we understand them, as people say, whether we hear them and see them, whether they're valued. You play a huge role in that, but also so does the advising, the general campus climate and what student affairs does, the ease or obstacles that administrative processes present to our students, the cost of the tuition or the financial aid. It truly is a task in which everybody plays a role. And again, very importantly, and I was really pleased to get a big round of applause on this during convocation when I said that, of course, we could fix our retention problem very easily by just raising our admission standards. But that, you know, at least at the undergraduate level, that is not the point. The point is to do well by the students we have, not by some other select group of students, because that's the kind of institution we are. The second challenge I talked about is the need to increase our research activity and research funding in order to really reach the level of visibility and scale, the economies of scale that we need. And I know that that's your big topic for today, so I'm not going to elaborate on that. You will deal with that very extensively. The third part I mentioned was the curriculum and pedagogy, which are relevant really for elevating student success. It's relevant for advancing excellence in teaching and research, and it's relevant for expanding our commitment to equity, because in curriculum and pedagogy, we talk both about what is the substance of what we teach. It was very interesting when I was in Cape Town this summer, I saw an article about a student protest at the University of Cape Town, basically saying they want a total revamp of big parts of their curriculum, which are still very European-centric. After all, it's the Dutch and the English that, you know, created that society in many ways, and the curriculum is based on them. They basically were saying, we want to hear about African history and social issues related to Africa, and only hear about the Western stuff to the extent that it's directly relevant to us. So it had a very clear echo to the things that play out differently here. You know, that South Africa is a very different society, of course, but the general question certainly exists. But it goes beyond the cultural content. It has to do with the different learning styles that we know more and more about, that, you know, we got to teach differently to different students. How you do that, that's not, you know, it's easy to say that. I know that's not just an easy thing to do. The need for hybrid learning opportunities that we've always talked about, how do we accommodate our students' very busy and complicated lives and facilitate them not having to always be on campus as the only mode of learning. How are we more market responsive? You know, and I know that, especially when you talk to a faculty of liberal arts and sciences and you use the word market or customer, you know, you're already a bad guy. But the reality is the world keeps changing and we need to think about what it is that people now need to know and what employers want which is not always to say is what they say they want, by the way, but you know, so that our students can get out and succeed. And the awareness that universities do not have a monopoly on knowledge and how people learn, and how do we creatively incorporate the different modes of acquiring knowledge, because again, if we do not do that, it will be done to us somehow or other. We have to be in the lead on that. The fourth issue relates to equity, very obvious. That's goal number four in the strategic plan. As you know, it raises the idea of applying an equity lens to everything we do. I think that's a very powerful concept, also a very difficult concept. You know, none of us fully knows precisely, maybe a few of you, but most of us don't know really what that means and how you do that. But if we can approach it as a joint learning process, it's a new world for many of us, and instead of sort of getting angry at the people who are just, you know, 6 months behind our own superior knowledge, you know, we can create a collegial climate where we can think about how do we do this in terms of the curriculum, the classroom approach, and so on. Perennial challenge, of course, is funding. Again, I'm not going to go into detail on that. You know, of course, we're going to fight hard in the legislature. November 8th is going to be the key date, you know, when we vote on Measure 97, and I cannot advocate one way or the other, but it is a difference between hoping to only have a $50 million cut over the biennium for the seven universities versus going for a $300 million increase for the seven universities. So you take your pick between those. I will also continue to work hard on the Coalition for College Affordability and Success, that sort of was the compromise that we struck when we withdrew the business payroll tax campaign. Still something that I certainly I'm feeling some pain over, but I'm very encouraged about our early meetings to look at new public sources as well as private sources. And then the capital campaign that the foundation is engaged in, and continue to look at increasing the number of non-resident students. These are all important parts of our financial picture. I also raised, and I will be sending out a letter to campus early next week, as a big challenge, the issue of free speech. You know, clearly a big topic nationwide. On the one hand, how do we encourage and welcome and support free speech while also maintaining a climate free of harassment in which people can feel welcomed on the campus? Now, these are among the tensions at a university and throughout the world that are real, that are not easily resolved by just either referring to the law or by little rote assumptions. They are real tensions. The old joke, I forget who said, you know, my freedom to extend my fist ends where your nose begins. And it's no different, except that in free speech and harassment, the notions of fist and nose are not always so clearly defined. So I think your college, more than any other, should be thinking about and contributing to our wisdom in how do we approach this very fundamental challenge of how do we honor these very two very important values of free speech and free expression, as well as the freedom to be free from harassment and be able to pursue your education. The final challenge is an opportunity is to hire a new president. And fortunately, I will mostly just be looking at that rather than being directly involved, although I will, you know, certainly help on some things. But my final comment on that actually goes back to the comment I made at the very beginning here, that you know, as I was thinking back about my own entry into this institution, I remember that the executive committee, you know, did at the time a great job, you know, teaching me the ropes and making me feel welcome, and the foundation board did a great job, you know, getting me engaged in the community. There were actually very few deans who kind of seemed to have thought about that it might make sense to invite a president to an event like this, to lectures or presentations. When I started outreach to departments to meet with individual departments, frankly, my assistant Rachel said, you know, I kind of have to beat them up and email them 12 times to get a response. You know, as faculty, as departments, and certainly as the dean's office, you know, reach out to the new president. Get him or her involved in your activities. Expose the person to it, because you know you're going to love what you know. You're going to advocate for what you know. You're going to raise money for what you know. And some of your individual units, you know, like Ken Ruoff, I don't see him here, the Center for Japanese Studies, was very good at that. Others who have wonderful, amazing programs, you know, I didn't find out about till, you know, last week or last year. So be proactive, because that is going to be good for the college, for you, and therefore for the university as a whole. Thank you all very much for being here today to do the important work that you plan to do today, and for being back for another great year. Go Vikes!
Thank you so much, Vim, and again, thank you for your leadership of our university. You can stay connected throughout this event and throughout the year with me on Facebook and Twitter. My Twitter handle is behind us, at PSU Class Dean, and you can comment on and continue our conversation online with the hashtag Class State of College. I know it's a little awkward. I'm thrilled to welcome 21 new faculty to the college this year. I met with this very distinguished group earlier this week, and I'm excited about what each one will bring to our programs. Their names and departments are listed behind me. I have a second slide because there are 21. New faculty, if you are here, please stand. Some of you are in the room. Welcome to the college. I'd also like to just take a moment to thank some of the key staff in the dean's office: Amy Ross, Chelsea Bailey, the associate deans Todd Rosensteel, Matt Carlson, and Delise Osland, who were instrumental in getting this event together today and in helping me think through some of the important stories and words that I need to share with you today. So please give them a round of applause. Today I want to talk with you about my vision for research and scholarship in the college over the next 5 years. And this is a really exciting topic for me because it's so close to my heart. It's a reason why I chose to come to Portland State 15 years ago, and I'm thrilled to be able to have a stage to share with you some of the ideas and then to move those ideas forward with you throughout the year. To lay the groundwork for that vision, though, I want us to take a few minutes to recall where we were just 2 years ago, when I gave my first State of the College address to you. 2 years ago, we were embarking on a conversation about the future of the college, whether to stay together as one college or split up into separate colleges. We surfaced several critical areas in the college that needed to be addressed. And although not unanimous, we decided that splitting the college would not necessarily address the problems that we were facing. I was charged then with working to mitigate those issues that were raised. And very briefly, some of the key issues were providing departments with more operational autonomy, improving transparency and communication, deepening advocacy within and outside of the university, fostering interdisciplinary collaborations, and clarifying of the vision for the college. On a daily basis, I work toward making improvements around these key issues, issues that are sometimes at odds with one another. Our work is by no means done and has not been perfect, but we have come a long way. I want to just highlight a few of the ways in which we started to address these problems over the last couple of years. I restructured the portfolios and hired 3 new associate deans and a new assistant dean for finance with significant input from all of you, the faculty and staff. Departments now keep a portion of their unspent budgets from year to year, what we now refer to as carry forward, so that you can engage as departments in longer range and more purposeful budget planning. That was a direct result and some ideas that we worked with our new fiscal officer on. We stepped up communication in several different ways. In addition to monthly coffee with the deans, look for the invitations that will come out this year. These are informal gatherings where anyone can drop in and talk with me and whoever else is in the room. I meet regularly with the college's members of the Faculty Senate Budget Committee and other Faculty Senate leaders, particularly to review budget planning, but also to communicate important issues in the college. I have a student advisory group who provides important feedback directly to me about their experiences, and we have a monthly newsletter and a monthly research brown bag. These are just several of the opportunities. I'm always looking for ways that we can improve communication, and you know I always tell you, don't hesitate to reach out to me. And about communication, I continue to tell you, don't hesitate to reach out to me if there are things that we can be doing better. Over the past 2 years, we've raised close to $12 million for the college, for faculty development, graduate student support, and undergraduate scholarships. We hired the inaugural director of our School of Gender, Race, and Nation, Dr. Winston Grady Willis. Winston, could you wave? He's in the back of the room. The new school, under Winston's leadership, will help us all further our thinking about intersectionality and how we operate in an interdisciplinary environment in teaching and scholarship. And as some of you know, we are taking this year to review the goals, vision, and structure of the School of the Environment. Interdisciplinary work is not always easy, and at times we need the space to step back and reflect on what is working and what is not working. We are taking time this year to be thoughtful, planful, and purposeful about our collective scholarly and curricular work that touches on the environment. You will be hearing more about opportunities to provide input and get involved in this revisioning effort. There is still work to be done in all of these areas. The last two bullets on the screen behind me, fostering interdisciplinarity and clarifying the vision for the college, are, in my opinion, the most challenging. They involve the most risk, the most uncertainty, and they require the most trust. They are also, for us in this college at Portland State University, deeply interconnected. When I examine how high-performing universities operate, how they behave, how they create narratives, and how outsiders talk about them, I see three features that are important. One of those is size, and by this I mean size of faculty and students served. A second is focus. They are focused on excelling in specific areas. And the third is performance. There are clear and measurable results. This can take many forms: the number of PhD students produced, the number of publications in top journals, the number of faculty awards, as examples. I want to comment on each of these, size, focus, and performance, in the context of our college. We are a large college. Everybody says that about us. We say that about ourselves. But I often ask the question, how do we take advantage of that size in strategic ways? Our reality is that the number of faculty in any one department or unit within the college is not going to significantly increase. You know the realities, and I know the realities. We must then think strategically about how we align ourselves across departments to take advantage of our size. That's all I'm going to say about size right now, but we're going to come back to that. Performance. I continue to be humbled and awed by the accomplishments of all of you, our faculty, and the work that you do in collaborations with students and our community partners. I have a long list in front of me, which is just a snippet of the awards and achievements that all of you have earned this past year. And I'm really going to be quick about this. I just want to go through and highlight a very few of them. Michael McGregor in English, his book, The Pure Act, The Uncommon Life of Robert Lax, was recently named as a finalist for the Washington Book Award. Rob Scheller in Environmental Sciences received the Distinguished Service Award by the U.S. chapter of the International Association for Landscape Ecology. Alex Rozica in Geology was named a fellow of the International Meteorological Society. Keith Kaufman in Psychology was given the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Association for the Treatment of Sexual Abusers. Shirley Jackson in Black Studies received the 2015-16 Doris Wilkinson Faculty Leadership Award from the Society for the Study of Social Problems. Our own Natan Mayer and Robert Lehman both were awarded the Foundation Philanthropic awards this year from the university, and in a clean sweep, Daniel Ballhorn from biology and Andrew Fountain from geology won both of the Research Excellence Awards given at the university. Very recently, this is just last week, Andrew Rice, Chris Butenhoff, and Aslam Khalil in physics led a research team that published a paper in the very prestigious Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences of the USA. This research was highlighted in an incredible article in the Washington Post. The Public Archaeology Field School at Fort Vancouver, led by Doug Wilson in anthropology, won the 2016 Diversity Field School competition, and it recognized the school's success in conveying the importance of archaeology to diverse youth and urban communities. Ken Stedman in biology, this is my favorite one, was a top five finalist for NPR's Golden Mole Award, which honors accidental brilliance in science. Our own David Banas and Hunter Shobey in geography published their book Portlandness, a Cultural Atlas. It has an amazing story of collaboration with students and the community. It was a number one bestseller at Powell's and also my holiday gift to almost everyone that I knew. Leslie Hammer in psychology received the International Rosabeth Moss Cancer Award for Excellence in Work Family Research, again, a very prestigious award. Peter Boghossian in philosophy and a team of PSU students created a new app called Atheos, designed to help facilitate respectful debates between atheists and people with different religious beliefs. Vandy Kanyenko in conflict resolution received a State Department award for Portland State University to be a host site for the Mandela Washington Fellowship Program for young African leaders this past summer. He brought 25 leaders to Portland State. We were the only university in the Pacific Northwest and the only other university on the West Coast aside from Berkeley who was chosen to host this program. Amazing work. Absolutely amazing work. And then finally, the PSU Anthropology Department's Archaeology Roadshow, led by Professor Virginia Butler, was selected for the National Phi Beta Kappa Award for its work building community and fostering stewardship of cultural resources. I could go on and on. I literally have pages here of these awards. The point is that we're excelling. I also have, aside from those types of facts, I have research metrics, so some of you may or may not know that every dean in the university has research metrics. I've set these for the college 2 years ago. They were developed in consultation with the department chairs, and we use them in collaboration with the Research and Strategic Partnerships Office. Our goals are projected behind me, and we will be collecting data again from all of you on publications and presentations. We'll be getting that from you this fall, so look for that call. But I'm pleased to report that, you can see that, that we increased the number of proposals submitted for external funding by 30% between 2014 and 2016. That's double the amount that I thought that we would do. So congratulations, this was all of your hard work. So I think that we have the performance part of this down. And then that brings us to focus. So unlike size and performance, I didn't have a tangible signpost to help me operationalize focus. This is a much murkier and, frankly, much scarier territory. I had to ask the fundamental question, can we identify research themes in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences? We opted to move together as one college, so I was hopeful that the answer to this question would be, yes, we can do this. Last spring, an opportunity presented itself to test this question. In addition to several retirements that happened throughout the college, we also had some unplanned resignations. And when I looked around and examined which departments these were in, we had 8 open positions in 7 departments, mainly, but importantly, not all in the natural sciences. The departments were biology, chemistry, communication, English, environmental science and management, geography, and physics. I felt that we were at a juncture. I could have the 7 departments conduct business as usual, go back and do their searches, as we always have, or I could challenge us to think bigger and think differently about how we hire, and I took up that challenge. I have a vision for the college to be more collaborative and to begin to do business differently, to take advantage of our size and our performance. This involves identifying areas of current strengths and prioritizing areas for future growth. I saw this cluster of open positions doesn't like me, as an opportunity to identify a focal direction and build momentum for that focal area through a cluster hire. We've all heard of these, certainly in other universities. And we've done a few in our own university, as it turns out. Rather than individual departments advertising one position each, I felt like we had the opportunity to advertise 8 positions around 1 or 2 themes, if we could identify those themes. So I stepped back and thought about, have we done this before? Do we have any examples? And in fact, we did have several examples, excellent examples at that, of identifying research themes and directions in the past. So I was hopeful that we could build on some of this momentum. And I want to briefly mention 4 examples. One of those is the gift by Dr. Faribor's Massey that recognized the potential in the Department of Mathematics and Statistics and endowed 3 professorships. The department then conducted a cluster hire in the area of computational mathematics, hiring 3 new faculty to complement the existing faculty strengths. I was in the department at the time that this was being developed, and as a faculty, we were highly involved in carving out what areas we would go after. As a result of those hires, we now receive more National Science Foundation funding by about double in applied and computational mathematics than either Oregon State or the University of Oregon. I'd say that was money well spent. A second example is the Center for Life in Extreme Environments. That center leveraged the research track record of 3 departments, biology, chemistry, and geology, to create collaborative lab space, and also doing this with the help of philanthropic support. The collaborative space has fostered cross-disciplinary grant proposals and has focused research groups around common themes. The third example is the Interdisciplinary Center for Applied Social Science. I know not many of you know about this, but you should, because it's a great model that you, A, may be able to take advantage of for you or your students, and B, should be thinking about how we can do more like this. We call this ICAS, and it's a collaboration between faculty in psychology, sociology, speech and hearing sciences, the School of Social Work, the College of Urban and Public Affairs, and the Graduate School of Education. ICAS members have collaborated over the last several years on the teaching of interdisciplinary graduate courses in qualitative research methods when they recognized that multiple programs across the campus were offering the same content to their graduate students in probably what were small classes. This was an incredible opportunity for faculty to collaborate, for students to have exposure to different but related interdisciplinary perspectives, and to be smart about resources and teaching assignments. ICAS members collaborated also on, in addition to the research methods course, to another one at the undergraduate level, and the faculty have been able to rapidly respond to new proposal requests that require teams of interdisciplinary investigators. ICAS faculty have submitted 7 interdisciplinary proposals totaling $12 million to date. And the final example that I want to draw on is also within the college. We've been building critical mass by hiring several what we call discipline-based educational researchers, or DBERS for short, because we love acronyms. These are faculty primarily in the STEM fields who have both disciplinary and educational research expertise, and they focus their research on undergraduate learning and teaching. We have DBERS, so to speak, in biology, chemistry, geology, and mathematics and statistics, and physics. And those faculty work in conjunction with faculty in sociology and psychology and are active in the new STEM Institute. The collaborations among the DBER faculty have resulted in several grants, several collaborative grant applications, and an active research group, and the first steps towards the development of a STEM teaching certificate program within the college. DBERS, as they're called, don't need to be just in the sciences. This is a group that can expand to involve discipline-based educational researchers in a variety of disciplines within our college. But this is a growing and active group that we made a strategic decision to help move forward. So based on these 4 examples, I felt that we had examples, and as mathematicians, we call this existence proofs, of being able to do such collaboration. So I brought together representatives of the 7 departments that had open positions, To answer the question, can we identify one or two research cluster themes? Could we actually do a cluster hire this year? And do you and your departments actually want to do this? What themes would transcend the departments? After several weeks and many hours later, we had an answer. And the answer was, yes, we can. And I'm just going to abandon my slides at this point. We now have an environmental extremes cluster hire underway. I had the language of what the job ad looks like on the PowerPoint. It's pretty exciting. But you can't see it. We'll get it out to you. The goal of the hires is to address the grand challenge of identifying the impacts, characterizing the adaptations, and designing solutions to manage and cope with environmental extremes of the 21st century. So we're hiring 8 faculty across these 7 departments. The faculty collaborated on a joint ad that is out. It's in the Chronicle, and it says, Portland State University's College of Liberal Arts and Sciences is hiring in these separate departments, but to address the key problems in the area of environmental extremes. It's the first time we've done something of this scale around collaboration. My hope is that the cluster hire will be an engine of both research and curricular innovations. Practically, it has allowed us to advertise all positions at both the assistant and associate levels. We're not expecting to hire all at the associate, but it's given us the opportunity to open that up. And this is an example of the power of our size at work. We have a good number of hires each year, we know this, but we've not thought strategically about how do we collect those hires and move them forward together when it makes sense. This doesn't mean that every open position has to then be funneled into a cluster hire, but it does mean that we should be thinking more strategically about how we move forward with our hires. If we are smart, strategic, collaborative, and creative in our hiring processes, we can continue to build strategic nodes of research and scholarship capacity. Over the summer, we also had focus groups broadly defined in the areas of social science and humanities, though I'd like to move away from those general descriptions. And we again asked the question, can we identify research strengths in the college? Unlike the extreme environment cluster, these conversations were not tied to the immediate need to write a job ad and think about how we would hire. And so they were focused on identifying existing research and scholarship capacity in the college and clarifying areas for strategic thinking about bringing existing college faculty together around these themes. And to give a context for future cluster hires. I'm not exactly sure what's going on with this computer. I also had on the slide a list of all the faculty who participated, which you, again, can't see. But there were virtually every department was represented, and we had probably, I didn't count because it was on the slide, but probably close to 50 faculty who engaged in these discussions over the summer. I really do see this as the beginning of our discussions about what can be our research and scholarship themes. So in addition to extreme environments, 3 other key themes emerged. One of those, yeah, you can take it. Sure. That's okay. One of these themes is pathways towards social justice. This may involve such topics as social determinants of health, education and social movements, cultural systems, environment, workplace, all with a lens of social justice. The second theme is community resilience and social ecological systems, which involves environmental and geopolitical risk, stressors, responses, including aspects of climate mitigation, adaptation, preservation, enrichment, and the creation of livable communities, keeping in mind heritage, identity, and long-term sustainability. And the third theme is building community capacity and peace in an era of local and global polarizations, extremism, and uncertainty. And again, I apologize that these aren't written at this point, but we will get these themes out to you. It was important for me to see that these themes emerged, and I see that they aligned well with Portland State's new strategic plan. So we have four themes identified. I think it's safe to say that the theme of extreme environments can be further fleshed out. There was a bit of an urgency around getting that theme together because of, again, the need to get job ads out and really think about moving a cluster hire forward. So throughout this year, we will be engaging with you to further refine and develop these focus themes. I think we have a good groundwork on which to build. We need to identify strategies and opportunities for our researchers across the entirety of the college to assist in supporting and growing our collective scholarship, and to use this focus on research themes to inspire, engage, and train our students, both undergraduate and graduate students, to be the change makers, leaders, and citizens we need for addressing the enormous challenges of the 21st century. I'm really viewing these themes as our grand challenges. This is what our college is going to contribute to the world through your research and our students. So throughout the fall and winter, we will see the first testing of this. We're going to have job candidates on campus delivering at least 24 talks on extreme environments. What a great lab experiment to see so many people coming to campus. The dean's office will be assisting in getting the word out about all of those job talks, and this is going to be a great opportunity. We're not only going to vet our future colleagues, but we're going to be provided the time and space to think, reflect, and learn together about our extreme environment research theme and further refine it. We will be developing processes also in the dean's office to bring together all of you, faculty, to refine and focus the additional themes developed this summer and consider themes that were not considered this summer. One of those venues will be the college's research brown bag, which over the past 2 years has highlighted the incredible research of our faculty once a month. We will be focusing the brown bag this year along these research themes, so having faculty giving talks on these research themes, which will again provide us some space to think and further modify. So my vision is that we are going to be building, and we've already started, several strategic nodes of research and scholarship capacity, and that in doing so, we're going to, scary word, change a little bit. We're going to change how we search for new colleagues. We're going to collaborate across departments to hire in clusters where it makes sense. And again, I emphasize where it makes sense. We have hires going on this year that aren't part of the cluster. So this is not to say that every single hire has to be part of a cluster, but I want us to be thinking strategically about doing it when it makes sense. I want us to also think about changing in how we hire. So working to ensure that our processes help build the diverse communities that we want and need in this college. And we'll be doing more support for faculty search committees and for department chairs around our hiring processes. I also want to change how we get smarter about delivering both undergraduate and graduate curriculum. I think the example from the ICAST group is a nice example of how we can look for ways that we don't need to teach 7 different qualitative methods courses, for instance. We can teach one that's going to save faculty time, and it's a benefit for our students to have the opportunities to collaborate with other students across departments and programs. We also want to draw on our incredible expertise that we're developing on the pedagogy of undergraduate learning and teaching. And we have that core with that deeper group here in the college. I would like to see that more of that continue. We need to change how we support faculty scholarship. And at the conclusion, well, the second part of our work today is going to be thinking together about how we can best support faculty scholarship in the college. Research is our value proposition. There are other universities in Portland, but no other universities in Portland have the capacity to serve students and engage in world-class research and scholarship like we can. Our scholarship, what we study, how we study, and with whom we study, is what differentiates us and will continue to differentiate us from our peers. Our future will be driven by the choices we make around research and scholarship now. I'm counting on all of your creativity, your energy, and your wisdom to chart that path forward with me. We will continue to engage in this discussion throughout the year. We're going to set success markers, and we're going to be on the road to meeting them. So thank you. I'd now like to invite Jason Podrovsky to the podium, not because Jason has been asking me for anything lately. many of you know Jason as biology faculty chair of the biology department. This year he's on an interim assignment as our associate vice president for research. And he's a valued member of our community here in the college. You don't have your access to slides either.
Nope. Okay.
Oh, you have a new laptop. Great. Okay. Jason's going to share with us a broader perspective on research, especially as it relates to the university's strategic plan. And then to give you a highlight of what's going to happen after Jason talks, I'm going to come back and ground some table conversations that I'd like you to have around some of the strategic visioning work that happened in 2012. Many of you were here and participated in those discussions. I've told this to many of you. I have that binder on my shelf and pull it out regularly on a weekly basis because there is such good information in there. I'm going to share with you some of the research task force's findings and then have us engage in a discussion about what we need to support our scholarship moving forward. You're done.
It's fried.
Oh, all right.
I put my slides after her slides,
and they're apparently fried. It was your word. There's
a flash drive. You can put it on right now.
It's actually fine. They're all looking, right? They don't have to look at my slides. I had 50 slides. And is this working? There we go. So for those of you that don't know me, first, thank you, Karen, for inviting me to come talk today. And thank you, Vim, wherever you went, for coming today. It's my pleasure to be here. It's so nice to see familiar faces. I've been kind of lonely over in RSP a little bit. You know, it's a really nice office with a really nice view, but it's so quiet over there. So when you go from a biology department with people yelling and screaming down the hallways and alarms going off to over there, it's been an adjustment for me. But anyway, I'm really happy to be here today. And what I wanted to do is give you a little bit of a view of what I've been tasked with. So for those of you that know me, it's probably you're wondering, you're asking yourself the question, why the hell did he say yes to this job? And I have asked myself that question 3 times over the last month and a half. So the reason is because it afforded me an opportunity. It's 1 year, right? So I stepped down as chair for a year. So I figure I can do anything for a year, even if it's terrible and even if I'm terrible at it, right? You guys will, you're nice to me, so you'll be patient with me. But mostly it was the tasks that Sana asked me to address during this year. So we were gonna be searching for a new VP for research. Now, about 2 weeks after, or maybe it was only a week after I accepted the job, we found out we'd be searching for a new president. So what we didn't wanna do is stop progress on a whole bunch of things that we had been working on. Whoa, that looks cool. All right, I like that. Now you guys get to see all my 50 slides.
47.
47, oh, let's see here. What I really just want to do is talk with you about the stuff that I'm going to be talking about today. So what I wanted to make sure of is that you realize when I say research, I mean the very broadest word, research. To search, discover, seek new facts, new things, create, be innovative, whatever, right? And I'm going to use it that way, and I'm going to mean everything. It applies to every discipline at this university. That's why we're here, right? And so I was, basically, when I was talking with Sana, she gave me the opportunity to really try to bring the two parts of the university together. The academic side, which I've been chair for 3 years. This is the price that you pay for being boisterous and always asking for things, apparently, wherever Karen went. Anyway, and the research side, because clearly all of us are here because that's what we want to do. We want to do both. We like teaching, we like research. There's some mix of the two, but we all enjoy both. So, and I also wanted to make a point. At Convocation, the president said, you know, we are a research university. A few weeks back with that, when that article came out in the Oregonian, it drove me crazy to ask the question, are we a research university? Of course we are, and we can say it because we think we are. Maybe some people here don't think we are. But what I wanted to point out is that the Carnegie classification system, which is applied to all the universities in the US, it's not a bunch of people that get in a room together and decide based on their reflections of a university. It's based on data and principles components analysis, right? So they're taking the way that we behave as a university and clustering us with other universities. So it's a basically objective way to say we're a research university, whether we want to be or not, apparently. Okay, so I'm hoping that we can change this year as we talk, and especially with all of the discussions that we've had in the college, which have been really, really positive in my mind, that we can stop asking whether or not we're a research university or not, and just embrace that we are, and rather talk about what kind of research university we want to be, and where do we want to grow in areas of excellence, okay? And so, it's a change in tone, and I hope to never see another Oregonian article like the one that was out there last week or the week before. Just to give you guys an idea of what the research landscape looks like, so I've been spending a month and a half. I know biology really well, I know class semi-decently, and after that my knowledge fell off precipitously. So I've been trying to educate myself of where do we do our research, where do we do our expenditures. This is a slide that was provided by Lisa Zirk, the person who had this position before me. And it gives you an idea of where research expenditures are distributed across the university. Now I'm going to show you this data on expenditures, and I'm going to show you one more slide on expenditures. And then later I'm going to tell you that research funding it's not the only thing that we have to worry about. The problem is it's the easiest thing to measure, right? Because we have accountants and we have to keep track of that. We're going to need your help to make it easier to measure research productivity, papers, presentations, things like that, so that we can show some metrics that actually show impact, because as you all know, money and impact don't necessarily correlate, okay? The next slide here shows what it looks like if you look at it on a per faculty basis by rank. So this is just expenditures for total research expenditures for the fiscal years 15 and 16, based on rank, assistant, associate, full, so this is only tenure track ranks. But what I wanted to point out is that we're clearly hiring and retaining people who are good at research and who are productive researchers. Look at that nice jump between assistant and associate. This is the average amount that's expended by those people on over a two-year time frame. But the whole point is that we would expect this if we were a research university to see that step up at each rank, and that's what we do. The president earlier referred to the strategic plan. So this is something that I'm going to admit to everybody, and you probably are all in the same boat with me, but my bosses around here are not going to like it. I hadn't looked at the strategic plan until I stepped into the provost's office. But there, it's on placemats, and every time you sit down, I'm serious, it is. They're laminated, and every time you sit down, the strategic plan is in front of you. And everything that we do is numbered by how it's plugged into the strategic plan. So whether you paid attention to the strategic planning process or not, the strategic plan is there and we have to pay attention to it. And the thing that I really like about it is that research and teaching are included in the same goal, right? They're not split apart, okay? So goal number two is what I'm gonna talk about, because that's what RSP is tasked with doing, is looking at research and how do we work with research here on campus. But I want to point out that there are four initiatives on this goal number two, the advanced excellence in teaching and research, and it's balanced between teaching and research. There's not five of them on teaching and one on research. There's two and two. And if we focus in just on those other two in a minute, you'll see that there are some very specific things that apply to all of the work that you guys already have a head start on as far as the university conversation is going. So Karen has led you guys in a way that puts you ahead of the curve, which should not be surprising to most of you that had to work with her. So maybe not had to work with her, who've had the pleasure of working with her. I just want to make a couple of points, though. Synergies between research and teaching. We all know they're there, but we don't necessarily talk about them all the time, right? There's the point that when you do active research, you're likely to be much more energetic and much more excited about the work that you're teaching, because you found something new. Maybe it changed the way that you looked at, you know, the topic that you're talking about. I remember a few years back when I was teaching cell biology, the textbook had some model for how a protein walked across the cell, and just that day, a new paper had come out about a new model for how it worked, and I was able to incorporate that in, and it made it way more interesting for me. I don't know about the students, but I was more interested, right? And I think that energy that you bring to the classroom is also good for the students. But the other thing is we know that students that get engaged in research and get engaged in research early in their career are retained more, they're happier, they're more engaged, right? So these things are synergistic, and we have to think about them as a whole. And we haven't done a lot of talking about them as a whole for the last few years, so I'm really glad to be hopefully a part of the conversation that we're going to have this year to bring the two together and think strategically about how we can do better in both research and teaching. Okay, so I'm going to focus mostly on initiative four. Goal two, initiative four, point one and point two. And I had the first time that I had my assignment where I had to say what I was going to do for the year, and then I had to categorize them by this. And I was like, oh, I had to go steal one of the placemats and I took it home. So anyway, but prioritizing for impact, okay? So we need to prioritize research investment, academic programs, development in areas that we're known for excellence already, okay? So in our strategic plan, we're looking at what do we already do well? Where have we already built strength? Where can we build on existing strengths? These areas should show the greatest potential for collaboration. This is clearly a theme that's important to a lot of people across campus, and obviously a way that you can break out of silos that we definitely need to break out of. And also in which we can have a competitive advantage, okay? And the other part of this is to prioritize and incentivize research, okay? I think all of you guys can get on board with that. This is why I was willing to take this job, because this is the conversation that I've been tasked with facilitating across campus this year. So I'd be doing it anyway, why not get paid for it, right? Okay. All right, so we all know this. How do you incentivize research? Well, we know we have a numbers problem, right? We have a small faculty compared to the number of faculty we have. I was actually pretty amazed when I looked at the numbers. So these are numbers off both of our, the OSU and the PSU website. So we have about 1,700 full and part-time faculty and just over 29,000 students. Oregon State has over 4,000 and roughly the same number of students, okay? They have a $285 million research enterprise. We have a $60 million research enterprise. So if you doubled our faculty, we wouldn't make it to OSU status, but we'd make it a whole lot closer, right? But we're not gonna do that. We all know that. There's no way that we're gonna double our faculty. So what we have to do is make it possible for the faculty we have to be as productive as they can be. And that's gonna require us to really think about what we do on a daily basis, okay? And this is the part that I think we haven't really talked about in the last little bit that I hope we can talk about as a group this year, which is figuring out how we can shift the culture to asking whether or not we want to be a research university and just figure out a way to make it possible for people to be happy and productive scholars and be innovative teachers and be innovative in the lab, okay? It is possible, we can do it, but we're gonna have to think about changing things. Maybe we're gonna have to think about changing the way that we present our courses. Maybe we're gonna have to think about the number of courses that we teach and reduce those. Maybe we have to utilize different technologies to get the information across with larger class sizes. I don't know what the answers are, right? That's not my job to figure out, luckily, or I wouldn't have taken the job. But I can talk with you guys about it. I'm sure that in this room there are solutions to these problems. But we have to actually be innovative about it. We have to think about it in a way that we're trying to maximize both and not just student credit hours, which we've been sort of trained to think about almost Pavlovian style for decades, I think. So anyway, hopefully we'll change this year. Okay, so the other thing that I've been tasked with, a couple of things. One is that each, as Karen mentioned earlier, each of the deans has a list of research metrics that they have agreed to be evaluated on. Now, not all of the colleges have actually developed those and implemented those, and Karen implemented them now, this is the second year, right? So again, class is ahead of the curve. But those metrics are meant to force deans to strategize for research innovation, okay? They're meant to create a culture where deans are trying to strategize to increase research productivity. So we have to think about how to do that in a way that's good for us as faculty, okay? Remember, I'm only half-time administrator. In fact, I'm 0.51 full professor of biology and only 0.49. AVP, so. All right, and I'm still wearing, for those of you that know me, I still have my Fear the Dark Side t-shirt. I'm wearing it today. All right, anyway, So some of the things that we need to do. So we need to develop 6 to 7 research focus areas as a university, okay? Areas that we can invest in, that we know that we can create some sort of excellence in. So we can't do everything, but so we have to choose what we want to be good at. And that's a conversation that has already started at the levels of the deans and in some of the centers around campus. And now it really needs to be to rest with the faculty, right? We need everybody to decide, you know, and not everybody's going to be in one of those areas, right? And not everybody has to be in one of those areas. We have to remain with this nice breadth of expertise. We're a university. We have to offer all of these sorts of opportunities, but we're going to have to choose where we can be super excellent, okay? And so that's going to be a tough conversation to have. And from my standpoint, I really would like to engage with the pre-tenure faculty on this because they're the ones that have the most to gain or lose from this. They have the longest theoretical time at this university. And I think that they're coming from other places. They've got a lot of ideas and we need to capitalize on that. So what I'll be doing is I'll be holding focus groups. I'll be coming to all chairs meetings. I have my own intern who, Lee Tapper is his name. He just graduated. He just retired from Intel. It's one of those Encore fellowship things. He's a great guy. At Intel, he was working with robotics and he worked with a number of different universities on building teams that could innovate in robotics. And he's going to be coming around and interviewing you guys and asking you what's working, what's not working, where you think there's potential. So we're going to have this conversation. I'm not quite sure how it's going to look yet because I've only been doing this job for a little while, but we'll get it figured out, or hopefully I will soon. Okay, so that's about all I wanted to say. I had to put this picture of Karen up because she came to our graduation ceremony and posed with our pet caribou. But the real question is, are we a university, a research university? Of course we are, but what kind do we want to be? Where do we want to be excellent? What do we want to be known for? What can we do together to create that? How can we create new programs and opportunities that allow us to grow this research endeavor here, right? And then, I would just say we're known for innovation, number 9 in innovation, right, by U.S. News and World Report. Can we innovate here? I think we can. I think it's going to be hard because I think I'm speaking as a department chair, you know, for 3 years I spent a lot of time fighting and duking it out for my group. And I think that we have to stop doing that. We've got a long history of departmental identity, I guess, here. And I think it's time for us to relax that a little bit and look for ways that we can build things that are bigger than individual academic units. It's going to be challenging. It is going to be scary. It's going to take a lot of trust. But I think this is a pretty safe group to work with, really. I think, you know, over the 3 years that I was chair, I can't think of any situation where I walked out of the room thinking that we didn't actually work together to solve some pretty major issues. Even when it came down to trying to cut budgets or remember when we had to band together to fight against a dean that will not be named. But anyway. All right, so that's all I had to say. Thanks for listening. When I come around and want to have these conversations, you'll know why. I think I'm going to try to get on the schedule for the all chairs meeting here one of the first months or something, if Karen will let me in. I don't know if she's decided to let me back in yet. No? Anyway, welcome to fall term.
Thanks, Jason. I think that Jason's underscored some really important messages about the interplay between teaching and research. And as the president said at convocation on Wednesday, we are both a teaching university and a research university, and that is what makes us unique. It's important that I just want to clarify, the university is also thinking about research themes on a very meta level. That shouldn't interfere with or in any way shape or direct what we're doing in the college. Our work is grounded by all of your work here, and we're going to be identifying our research themes and moving those forward. We'll be looking for places where they strategically intersect with things at the broader university level, but that should not kind of stop or slow down our work together. I do, now that our slides are back, I do just want to recognize the faculty who took part in the discussions this summer. And here are the departments and the names of the faculty. It was really intensive work. It was hard work. I want to thank Todd especially for leading this. Matt and Delise were also key parts in these conversations. It was scary to go in and ask a question, can we try to work together when we really haven't had that culture in the past? And so I just want to, these were incredibly brave individuals and incredibly collaborative, smart, just willing individuals to take part in these conversations. And so they deserve to be recognized and need to be thanked for their work, which is going to really propel us this year in order to take on these important research themes that we need to carve out. Sorry to advance like this. There it is. In 2012, as I mentioned, we had a Research Innovations and Strategic Partnerships Task Force. And at the very bottom here, this will direct you to a Google site where you can access all of the task force reports, including this one on research. I wanted to review some of the recommendations that came out of this group's work, and they were looking at how to support faculty research and scholarship, and then I'm gonna have you all weigh in. And I want to get to a little bit more finer grained than some of these bigger themes that are up here. So on the slides behind me are several examples from that task force, really responding to the question, what do faculty need to excel in their research and scholarship? And so these are not surprising. They weren't surprising to me. They're not going to be surprising to you. Time, graduate students, professional development funds, expectations for hiring, promotion, and review, fundraising to bring in funds for faculty work, et cetera. You can read those. I want to comment in particular on bullet number 3, because this was one that I was starting to work on within the college, and then we had kind of a great event happen at the university. So beginning this year, each of you, each faculty member in the university has access to an individual professional development account. We call these IPDAs because we acronyze everything. So you can accrue funds in your individual professional development account for up to 4 years. For tenure track faculty this year, you have $1,000 in that account. For non-tenure track faculty, $600, and for academic professionals, $500. I want to be clear on my expectations for tenure track faculty in particular about the use of these funds, particularly because this came up in this task force, and because when we were having a conversation a couple of years ago, funding for scholarly activities was a big idea that emerged, was a big theme as an obstacle. So I expect that the funds are going to be used to advance your research and scholarship. Your department chairs will sign off on the use of those funds. It doesn't have to be limited to travel, but it certainly can and should be used to help fund you to present your work at conferences, measuring impact, as Jason had described. But also, if you need to travel to libraries or sites to do research or do field work, those funds can be used for that. If you need to pay for page fees to get your work out in publications, or if you need to publish materials and books in order to actually conduct your research. The bottom line here is that I expect to see an uptick in those measures, in publications and in presentations as a result of access to these funds. So I know that they were desperately needed. I'm also not foolish enough to think that this is going to solve everything because you now have access to $1,000. I know you need more, but this is a start, and I think that this is a step in the right direction. And the thanks here really goes to the bargaining teams who worked on this, because it was through the AUP contract and bargaining that this came about. But I applaud. I think this is really fantastic. So here are some, these are some of the things that we know that we need access to help us really, really delve deeper into our research. And what I'd like you to do now is first reflect on. So you have kind of a list to help generate some thinking. You've all been doing research, so you also know. But what is it that you need to sustain or expand your research and scholarly activities? And I really want you to be as specific as possible. So for instance, if you know graduate students was on the list, what is it that you need graduate students to do for you to help you further your research? Because it's going to be different in different departments, and I want to understand the nuances and differences for how you would need to use graduate students. What I also thought was very interesting in this task force report is that the task force included the statement, including sharing across departments. That's fantastic. There are germs of and seeds of interdisciplinary collaboration that come about in all of these task force reports. If you're saying time for what? What is it that you need to do less of and what is it that you need to do more of? Is it time throughout the whole academic year or just in the summer? So I would like that level of detail. So I want you to take a few minutes, just quietly reflect. It's just helpful for us to just to kind of get in the mode of like thinking about like what's most important. You'll be free to write up and discuss kind of as many of these tools as you think you need. So I'd like us just to take a few minutes. I'll give you a signal then, and start writing on post-it notes. What I'd like you to do is two things. It's to have a discussion at your table, and I ask that you please include everyone in your table in that discussion. Feel free to move around tables to make sure that you're with others. And then I'd like you to get these up on the sticky notes on the walls. For a couple of reasons. One, in the past, we found this is a great way for me to just collect the information from you. It'll also give you an opportunity to see what other tables are, the ideas that they're talking about and discussing. So just for a few minutes, think, write, enjoy the silence for a few minutes, and then I will give you a prompt to engage with each other at your table.